Indonesia, ancient temples, strange writing on the stones. Doesn't look like the old Malay, which according to mainstream history is the first language over there. Even less similar to the classic Malay. A bit more similar to some other ancient scripts of the region, but still not the same. Why there is no mention of this script in the mainstream history? Is it because the same runic symbols are found in regions which supposedly had nothing to do with Indonesia? Very similar, if not the very same symbols, for example, from the pyramid in the La Mana, Ecuador. And not only the symbols in Ecuador are very similar, also the attitude towards them. There is no culture whatsoever that should have created anything similar to this in the history of the region of Ecuador in full South America. And school books even assure us that there was no such writing of any sort at all there. The Indonesian symbols seem also very similar to those on the Kensington stone from US. The tablets from the pyramid in La Mana are not some isolated case. There are plenty, actually hundreds of artifacts from South America with this writing found in various locations, not just one. And a lot of artifacts with runes, the same runes as South America, are found all over North America. And if you have any doubt that these American runes have anything to do with the European, please have a look at this artifact found in the same collection. I guess this looks pretty familiar. And not only European artifacts are there in the collection. It seems the crowd was pretty much international, which is not strange because we saw the same situation in most corners of Earth anyway. This looks Egyptian. Again, here we see Egyptian hieroglyphs, and also maybe one of the persons has this snake or kundalini, whatever depiction that the Egyptians wore on their forehead. Well, it's not clear on this photo, but on another small statue that is found in the Toronto Museum, we clearly see a Native American with that same decoration. Well, this stone is precious because we have few languages on it. You can also see the Sumerian writing in the very center and on the bottom. And runes are found all over the world. This is from Turkey. Also, what is called the Paleo-Hebrew seems to be very, very similar to those runes. And more or less all ancient nations of Europe used runes, that is well studied. Some other ancient Asian scripts are also very, very similar to the runes. And these two are from India. The Saudi Arabians also had their, well, is it runes or pre-Sanskrit? People call it with the different names. But it is very, very similar to what we saw in Indonesia, in South and North America, of course, all over Europe. They also have a few generations. Gradually, the older ones turn into proper runes, almost identical to those of Europe. These two generations are from Saudi Arabia still. It is entirely possible that their scientific name is different. Even the very same runes in Europe, in different countries, they bear different names, as if they are different scripts altogether. And now this is Ethiopia. They have runes there as well. On the left side of the stones, Also, I can't fail to notice the survivors' symbols, same ones that the samurais have on their heads, and also the many of the Egyptian gods have exactly the same symbol on their forehead. And eventually, when the religion of Islam appeared from the original philosophy of the survivors, they accepted the crescent as their symbol, main symbol. The very presence of runes worldwide suggests just by itself the existence of a one world culture in the past. But for the modern mainstream history, this is such unbearable heresy that they have to take measures that such ideas don't become prevalent in the society. And how they do so is by making the artifacts of this worldwide culture unavailable. That is why a very small fraction of the historic artifacts, estimated at average of 15%, are available for public study and are exhibited in the museums. The excuse is no place in the museums, but we live in an age of advanced technology. Is it that difficult to photograph them and open them for public viewing, or make them accessible at extra fee because they will need to provide some guide? You know, they cannot let you alone in the museum vault, so some personnel could be paid to accompany you and show you the artifacts at an extra fee. But that is not possible. That is not even an option. The most important artifacts of this worldwide culture, they're so important that they don't even reach the museums. They go straight forward from the excavation sites to where? Well, yes, alternative researchers have been asking this, and they have been contacting people who do the actual excavation work on the sites and ask them what happens to these questionable artifacts, and people from all over the world give the same answer. It all goes into some boxes that are numbered, and there is no name, no information where it goes, and then it disappears without trace. But of course, you cannot just put everything in boxes and take it away. A lot is left, enough to find out the truth. So what is the procedure with the artifacts that are not immediately dispatched in numbered boxes? Well, they try their best to declare them as hoaxes, even when there is absolutely no ground for such a discussion. And when that fails or is unsuitable due to situation, then the last resort comes. Well, they're simply ignored. And not only the runes are same all over the world. Look, for example, at the megalithic structures that are found all over the globe, as if the same stonemason worked in Peru and in Turkey and in Japan and in Cambodia. Absolutely same building style, up to the smallest detail, same clamps, same corners, same polygonal way of putting the stones together, and everywhere the gap between the stones is almost zero. All this doesn't fit at all the mainstream story that these people figured it out all separately. And not only the building and the culture is very similar worldwide, but the people are the absolutely same people who spread it everywhere. You remember the Caucasian mummies in China? Well, the absolutely same people were the head of the advanced culture in Egypt. Just the very look of this Egyptian mummy, even without performing tests on it, it becomes clear to what kind of group of people it belonged. Artifacts, Egyptian artifacts, confirm this blonde, blue-eyed looks. Same mummies are also found on the Canary Islands. If you have seen Planet of the Megaliths, you will be familiar with the pyramids over there as well. Same, absolutely same situation in Peru. Blue eyes, light-haired mummies, Caucasian features, Caucasian DNA. On an old photo, we also see a blonde child in Hawaii. Amongst the Maoris, this doesn't happen naturally in their race. And again, in their race are the Pato Palarehe people of New Zealand, which didn't agree at all with the mainstream history of New Zealand. That's why they declared it to be legend, although same people are living even nowadays. Now, this mummy from Iran barely needs any explanation. Not only the blonde hair, but the very facial features speak for themselves. Now, do you notice the blonde braid on this mummy? It's actually a tall Caucasian lady and it's found in Russia, but in regions that are officially considered to have been inhabited in ancient times by other races. Actually, exactly at the time when everybody in Russia was in shock from the news about the exploding war in Ukraine. In that moment of confusion and distracted attention, some unknown people approached the Russian authorities and actually convinced them somehow that, you see, it is not good to have this mummy like this. It is disrespectful to the dead. You have to actually burn it or put it in the ground or somehow, anyhow, get rid of it, because this is disrespectful to the spirit that resided in this body. And all this was done very silently, anonymously, and without any publicity. But because Russian people have and watch and believe many documentaries like the Survivor series, they're not so stupid and they understood what's going on, and they made such a social upheaval against it that this project of disposing of the uncomfortable mummy was exposed and stopped, and the Russians are still in possession of their valuable artifact. So on one side, we have mummies and remains of the same people all over the world. On the other hand, we have uniform megalithic building style all over the world, and that the mainstream history also didn't notice. And it didn't notice one other detail as well, that in all these megalithic ancient structures, we see a clear devolution of the building techniques. Please notice how the Incas were repairing what the previous builders left for them. We clearly see the lower quality work on the top of the high quality one. That means that the advanced techniques devolved into the later primitive ones. Again, here, South America, we see the mud bricks on the top. That means they happened later on in time. The next example is Baalbek. On the bottom, we see enormous, huge stones that fit together perfectly. And then the addition done by subsequent repairs, look at the quality of their work. It looks like the primitive Inca stonework. Another photo to compare the quality of the older style appearing on the back and the most recent additions appearing in the front. Same situation in Pompeii. All researchers, even mainstream one, agree that the perfectly shaped huge megalithic blocks are remain from the oldest building layers. We see same like polished surfaces even inside, enormous size of the blocks, standard as we see everywhere in the world. And then the bricks and the smaller stones belong to the later devolution stages of building in Pompeii. For example, on this photo, the bigger, older blocks were reused in making the new house. The same tendency of devolution is clearly noticed in Rome. In the foundation of the building and in the older building layers, we see classical megalithic blocks, perfectly polished, huge, smooth, complex shapes. And as the time goes on, the red brick work appears on the top. In reality, the so-called Great Roman Empire was just one of the numerous places that serve as example how the survivor culture gradually devolved, and nothing more. No wonder that on all old maps, there is no Roman Empire at all, or cartographers of that time depict absolutely different countries. Isn't it strange? The most prominent scholars and historians and cartographers of their time were not even aware of the existence of the biggest country, supposedly, at that time in history, and some of them were even living in it. There will be a lot of surprises in the episode about the so-called Roman Empire. Do you see the so-called ancient inscription here that tells us who built the world-famous Pantheon in Rome? Well, strange that in the older depictions, this supposedly ancient inscription is missing. Another very good example of devolution of the original survival techniques is the Temple Mount of Jerusalem. In the bases, we see enormous huge stones having very similar dimensions like the famous trilithons of Baalbek. And not only the size of the stones is comparable. If you look at the very building style, as if the same master mason made both structures, absolutely same technique, same style, same appearance. But that is only in the lower layers. On the top, we see typical medieval wall building, smaller stones that do not fit each other well. Again, here below we see huge stones perfectly fitting each other, completely different building style. And on the top, where they have eroded or were broken down, we see a very chaotic building, a lot of distance in between the stones. Actually, some of these stones on the top are old, but they have been reused in the construction at a later stage of history. And another proof of that is that many of these stone in the subsequently added wall, they have some sort of engraving that doesn't match the pattern. Obviously, initially this stone belonged somewhere else. An identical drastic devolution that we can see in the building techniques of Bogaskale, nowadays Turkey. On the bottom, we see gigantic, well-polished, survivor-style megalithic blocks, having the same complex, elegant shape and the same walls as their brothers from Peru and all over the world, actually. But again, that's only in the very low layers. On the top, we see basically a raw stone put together, and the blocks don't fit each other well. They are connected with mud or other basic and primitive techniques are used. Again, here we see elegant, regular, smooth stones amongst the raw ones. Some people who prefer never to leave the comfort zone of their established orderly beliefs say, "What is this all noise about? Mainstream history admits that there are mysteries. It is absolutely normal that unresolved mysteries do exist. They will be solved in the future." They continue, "You cannot call the mainstream history hoax just because it hasn't explained everything. It takes time." Well, such a line of thinking has nothing to do with the scientific approach. If history was really a science, it should have based its stories on the artifacts, which is not at all the case. And the idea to base one's belief in mainstream science just because it will confirm its theories in future is clearly basing one's belief on fairy tales, because these future discoveries are not yet here. These imaginary discoveries do not exist at all, and we cannot base science on imagination. This is not science. Other group of people who are slightly more adventurous reach a bit further. They are not afraid to realize that the official so-called history is basically historical fiction, not something that really happened. But they will still have difficulty bid farewell to the artificially and deeply implanted idea that humans came from animals and humans are animals. And that is why they say, well, but it doesn't seem to me that there is any reason to connect these remains of old advanced building techniques and in some cases even technology with the Atlanteans. It must be aliens or something else, but Atlantis seems still more like a legend to them. So let me explain why do I connect these artifacts with the survivors of Atlantis. Well, first of all, I use Atlantis as a collective name to signify all the ancient advanced civilizations. The first reason for which I connect the Caucasian mummies and worldwide megaliths to Atlantis is the fact that the oldest and most accessible for us books on the real history is the Vedic literature from India. It has reached us in unedited form, and over there it is clearly written, crystal clear, that the bedrock of our current civilization was not shaped by the Greco-Romans, but by the survivors of an older civilization which was far, far more advanced than us. And that was not some sort of a local Indian thing. Again and again, it is clearly stated that it was a worldwide culture. There were no countries. There was no war. It was just one world, beautiful, peaceful culture. In addition, they have many volumes of detailed description of the process of how this culture fell apart and the wars that brought about this demise of the divine culture. It is not a minor detail that could be interpreted or translated in different ways. It is the main theme of the vast Vedic literature. It's an enormous, huge body of literature. But this is not the only source at all. Link number 23 in the description points to a video that depicts the result of a scientific project done by the Farsight Institute. They used modern scientific methods and reached the same conclusion that the older advanced civilization was destroyed. Well, they focus on one particular moment of it. It's not as detailed as the Vedic literature, but it's absolutely in the same line. You can see the video for yourself. You can skip the preface and start from minute 14 or something. And please bear in mind that their research is not based on some fantasies, but that the people who have done the remote viewing didn't even know what are they viewing. They're just given a random number and that's all, nothing else. They don't even know is this a historic object or anything. And yet all the remote viewers see the absolutely same thing and same details that we find in the old legends and old scriptures. Getting all the minor details correct cannot happen by some sort of strange coincidence, nor is a coincidence that people who are born with naturally inborn astral vision, proven and well established, also see the same details about the history. And the amount of such people with special abilities is just huge. Here I will present few quotes only from Edgar Cayce for the simple reason that he doesn't need introduction. Although the information channeled by him is not 100% reliable, still he has countless well-documented cases of being able to channel absolutely amazingly correct information that an ordinary person could not have had access to. What follows are just very few short quotes from the vast amount of material that Edgar Cayce has left for us on Atlantis. Here in the first quote, we even see details of the very splitting of the island of Atlantis. Even the very details of the splitting correspond to other legends and ancient sources, which I'm sure Edgar Casey was not personally familiar with because he was a Christian and not a particularly expert in all the pagan scripts. Now, from this quote, we understand that the Atlanteans were also connected with older culture, like the Lemurians, or also called Lumerians. Well, for many, many thousands of years, people were aware of the previous to them advanced civilizations. Strange that only we, the very so-called advanced ones, think that we were monkeys, actually. Here Edgar Casey mentions what I call parasites. Apparently this party was active already in Atlantis, and it was them who blew it up with their experiments. Actually, in Edgar Casey terms, the sons of the Law of One are the good survivors, and the sons of Belial are the parasites. Well, at the end, with their experiments, they caused a gigantic volcanic upheaval that destroyed them almost completely. And here is when the Edgar Casey information starts overlapping the New Chronology Project information, where in Egypt, some 1,000 years ago, we already have advanced culture. Some connect this quote with the Basque people of Spain, which is correct in a way, because their outfits and very culture definitely belongs to the general survivor style that is prevalent all over the world, actually. We saw the same style of clothing in the Berber communities of Africa, and here we see it all over Europe on this couple of photos. This traditional shamanic religion is the last remain of the Atlantean culture, although it is almost unrecognizable. From this quote we find out that the survivors did not establish the Egyptian culture for the first time, they just joined an existing culture. Here we get some hints about the transportation technology that they were using. Now, this statement of Edgar Casey fits much better to the actual historic buildings that we find in the Yucatan in comparison to the mainstream version of the origin of those buildings. Now, this information is confirmed by various, not only one, ancient Native American codexes that give testimony of the arrival from the island of Aztlán. The arrival of the people who gave this culture to the locals. Which culture? The culture that built the amazing Teotihuacan, using, for example, very strong reinforced concrete, and in an architectural style that is very similar to what their brothers were building across the ocean. Now, this quote is in full coherence about the science of the survivors as I depicted in the episode on this topic. For more Edgar Casey information on Atlantis, please follow link number 22 in the description. And as far as how the further migration of the survivors continued on the territory of Europe, Asia and Africa, here we have considerably more sources, like the Book of Veles, some amazing Scandinavian sagas, and some legends, like under number 24 you can follow a link. There is a free book on the subject of Ireland, Land of the Fairers. Basically, that would be how one of the first waves of survivors migrated from Egypt to Scotland.